last time we talked about the spirit of Cardano, why it has such a unique and marvelous governance scheme. This time we're gonna take it up a notch. Remember when I said that Cardano is considered a third generation cryptocurrency? Well, in this video you're gonna find out why. But before that, be sure to watch the other Cardano video after this. It has some great insights you don't wanna miss. Now, Cardano has three pillar solutions: scalability, interoperability, and sustainability, which we shall talk about momentarily. To recap from the previous video, the objective here is to build high assurance code, code that cannot fail under any normal circumstances, which is important since we're dealing with assets. So let's start with scalability. People tend to throw this word around without fully grasping what it really means for a cryptocurrency to scale. The usual benchmark used for scalability is TPS, or transactions per second. This is also called the throughput, but please note that this is only a third of the three facets that comprise scalability. Currently, Bitcoin can do 7 TPS, while Ethereum can do around 15. Obviously, this isn't enough to handle worldwide adoption. Visa normally processes 1,700 TPS. That's a huge gap. So Cardano's response is Ouroboros, their very own peer-reviewed consensus mechanism, utilizing a variant of the proof-of-stake algorithm. According to their research, Ouroboros is the first proof-of-stake protocol to be mathematically proven to be secure. So Cardano believes this will address the TPS problem without a substantial risk of failing. The second facet of scalability is network bandwidth. Bandwidth is essentially the speed of data traveling through a path across the internet. Like when I send an email, the data gets routed into different paths, but it reaches its destination fairly quick since email data is light. However, if I upload a 2GB video, it would take longer for the data to completely reach its destination. Now, this relates to crypto because in a distributed ledger like blockchain, data is traveling all the time. It needs to, because we are constantly updating as new transactions go through. Also, the nodes have to agree on the data in order to maintain consensus and prevent any tampering from fraudsters trying to rig the system. Going back to my email and 2GB video example, the point is that data needs to be able to move fast and seamless. This is one of the reasons why Bitcoin imposed a block limit. Some people saw that as an internal sabotage, but what really happened was they curbed the TPS scaling a little bit in order to maintain the capability of network scaling. Because we need the nodes to be able to pass around and receive blockchain data in due time. Only then can we ensure that the network is still being honestly validated. So the idea that we need the network to be homogeneous, that is to say, alike in every node, is important for decentralization. Like, how else do I know that I'm getting the complete data that the network agrees to be true if I don't receive the data in time? So it's important that data can travel throughout the blockchain or network fast. You see why network bandwidth needs to scale too? So Cardano's answer to this is a technology they call RINA, Recursive Internetwork Architecture. Basically, it's a new type of network structure with the goal of creating a homogeneous network. What's interesting is that RINA is actually a proposed alternative to the current mainstream backbone of the internet, which is TCP/IP. Now, you don't need to know much about this if it's too technical for you. What you need to realize is that RINA is a technology that could become the new backbone of the internet, and Cardano is taking advantage of it. Now, the third facet of scalability is data scaling. This is a great issue that is being talked about a lot in the Bitcoin community, especially against other forks like Bitcoin SV. Because Bitcoin SV just keeps increasing the block size to seemingly no end. but doing so has immense consequences in terms of scaling the data. You see, a blockchain is a database of transaction records. Now, these records are stored forever. So with that in mind, you get the idea that as the number of users grow, so will the volume of daily transactions, and consequently the whole blockchain size. Now, since the blockchain just keeps getting bigger forever, you'd expect that at some point in the future, only big data servers can afford to run a node. You and me won't. Then decentralization dies. So what is Cardano's plan? They are looking into four solutions: pruning, subscription, compression, and partitioning. Pruning is basically running a smaller version of a full blockchain by deleting older data that it no longer requires while downloading the latest blockchain data that is necessary. Compression is making the blockchain smaller. An example for this is the Mimblewimble protocol. Partitioning is like slicing the blockchain into different parts so they can be managed separately but still achieve consensus. So the idea here is to combine these different techniques intelligently and come up with a solution that allows the data stored by each node to be less demanding in terms of hard drive space. According to Charles, there won't be one cryptocurrency to rule them all. So it's more logical to work on the assumption that there will be many different coins that will coexist. Therefore, the second pillar of Cardano is interoperability. Today, we have different cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and Ethereum and Stellar. On the other hand, legacy financial systems like banks are still around, and they use technologies like SWIFT to move money around similar to how we use blockchain. None of these are interoperable. Okay, maybe Stellar and banks. But Stellar isn't interoperable with Bitcoin or Litecoin or other tokens for the most part. Neither are Bitcoin and Ethereum compatible to each other. Same with Litecoin and Dash. You see the problem here? I don't know, it's like everyone is working with the premise that only one coin could win. There are a few exceptions, but the greater part of the crypto market seems to act like this, creating silos and preventing unity, which by the way is a really good strategy to win, and 1,000 times easier to do than trying to become the next Bitcoin. So it is a breath of fresh air that Cardano is prioritizing interoperability. Imagine an internet of blockchains where Bitcoin can flow freely into Cardano, to Litecoin, or to any other blockchain without needing any exchange or intermediaries at all. That would be phenomenal for the industry. And there are two technologies to make this happen. One is atomic swap, which the Bitcoin people are heavily developing, and sidechains, which Cardano is looking into and planning to implement. The third pillar of Cardano is sustainability. Now, Charles admits that this is the toughest problem to solve. It's very difficult to create a system that would fund the future development of a decentralized entity. The usual method is through an ICO, which they did, but it's not going to be enough for the long-term development, especially the way ICO works where founders suddenly receive a huge sum on day one. It's just not a good way of funding and not really sustainable on its own. Another way is through patronage, that is, receiving funds from entities like governments, foundations, or companies. But that too is prone to centralization, because whoever gave the donation might influence the development of Cardano. So Cardano instead plans to use the treasury model, which was inspired from Dash. But how does it work? Well, every time a block is added to the Cardano blockchain, part of the block reward goes to a treasury. A mining reward in a sense, but not directly paid to the developers. But instead, when someone wants to develop something, they simply submit their proposal to the treasury to ask for funding. Like most decentralized communities, stakeholders vote on which proposals are going to be granted funding. So basically, those are the three pillars of Cardano. See you on the flip side, guys.